Open up in your Bibles today to the book of 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2. Praise God. In the light of the election result last night, and we're already ministering on the subject of prayer, seemed like God just dropped an on-time, you know, something for me to say to you tonight along this line. And we've been talking, if you've been with us in the midweek services of late, about uncharted territory. What is uncharted territory? Well, it's you've never been there before. And Mom Arlene, who has been our prayer leader and director, kind of spearheading the prayer ministry here in the church, she talked to me on occasion about that scripture that I think that God exhorted Joshua about as they were about to move over in across the Jordan into the promised land. He said, "You've not been this way before." Right. Hallelujah. And we as the church are in a new era. Yeah. Yeah. I don't have time to rehearse all that. It's a new time in church history and in the history of humanity on this planet. God's doing a new thing. And what is that? Well, everything He's done in previous moves of God, only more of it and all of it wrapped up together, that's what He's endeavoring to do before Jesus comes. Right. And prayer, becoming skillful in the prayer life, is going to play a huge role in moving this era forward. Pastor Nancy taught us that, and I believe it, I see it in the Word, that prayer moves the plan of God forward. Prayer moves it forward. And so one of the things that you can check, if you don't feel like the plan of God for your life is unfolding at a very good pace, you know, do you see the hand of God in your life moving you forward? The things that He stirs in your heart and has put in your heart, that should not stagnate. Sure, there's times of waiting and there's seasons and things have to unfold. And sometimes those things will take a month or a week or a year. Sometimes it'll take a decade, two or three decades to get to ultimately where God has you. You know, the Lord said to me one time, I think it's in this particular prayer journal, so that would put it within the last couple of years. He said, "Son, now just hold out. I'm keeping you back here in reserve. And I'm training you." I'm like, okay. But see, there's a day out there ahead of me where God's going to use me on a greater level than He's using me now. And I don't mean leaving here. I just mean how He's using me. Amen. Amen. That's true for you. Where you sit tonight, you're not at the pinnacle of where God has planned to take you. Amen. And so, but one of the things that you can ask yourself and test yourself in is, am I praying enough to fuel the plan of God forward? You know, in my own life, it wasn't until I was filled with the Spirit and began to speak with other tongues that things didn't, you know, I can point back and say, when I was filled with the Spirit, I began to speak with other tongues, and I don't mean hours a day, but I mean 10 minutes, 15 minutes, here a little, there a little. Desires immediately began to come up in me that I wouldn't conjure them up. Desires for ministry, desires to preach, desires for this and desires for that. Where are these desires coming from? As I'm praying, the Spirit of God who's in me, who knows everything about the plan of God, He's having more way in my heart, and He is able to communicate to my mind more of what He has for me. Amen. So the more you pray, or Father, I'm just taking time to pray out the will of God for my life and just take off in other tongues while you're driving down the car, driving down the road in the car, whatever it may be. Keep your eyes open. Do us all a favor. Keep your eyes open. But see, you'll pray that. Think of praying in tongues for your prayer life as laying track for the train. That train, it's got an engine, it's strong, it's mighty, it's able, it can do it, but it can only go as far as the track you've laid for it. Yeah. Said another way, concerning the plan of God for your life, if you want to walk it out, You have to pray it out. And so for those who aren't prayers, you haven't laid a lot of track for your for the engine of your life to run on. But see, you can pick it up. And see, a lot of times we are setting the pace. The more I pray in the Holy Ghost, the more I'll see happen. Amen. Well, we've been talking for the last several Wednesday nights about the prayer of faith, specifically. The prayer of faith and becoming skillful with the prayer of faith. I've taught 4 or 5 lessons on that. But I wanted to say to you tonight that we don't want to leave the impression that praying the prayer of faith is the only kind of praying. Because it's not. I said it's not. Amen. There are other kinds of prayer, and if the prayer of faith is all we needed to get the job done, He wouldn't have given us these other kinds of prayer.
Right.
Amen. So again, I can pray the prayer of faith for myself and get an answer every time. But for other people and their situations, I can't necessarily pray the prayer of faith and get the outcome. But I can pray for them. Through a different kind of prayer. Hallelujah. And that's what we want to delve into tonight. Amen. Just to cut to the chase. I believe the church is awake. I believe the church is awake. I totally understand. I'm not going to get political. I totally understand from certain perspectives. Admiration for our current president. And we should find the positive and exalt the positive and honor the man that is in the office. We should do that. The Bible teaches us to do that. But at the same time, I believe that the nation has been under judgment. And any time that you see, if you study the biblical record, how does God judge nations? When He chose Israel for Himself and made a nation out of them, and they rebelled against Him, He would give them over into the hand of their enemies. He would. And the way that worked is a ruler would come over them that treated them wrong, that was evil and unruly and wicked and evil intended toward them, whether it was Pharaoh or Nebuchadnezzar, all kinds of things. And under the weight of that wicked government, the people often would get oppressed and tired of that after a while. And what they would begin to do is cry out to God. They'd begin to cry out to God, oh God, oh God. And you know, I believe that the church has been crying out to God. Amen. And our prayers were answered. Don't know how to tell you that, but I mean, just our prayers were answered. Whatever you think about it in the natural, the prayers of the people were answered. I wanted to show you something here about our prayer life. 1 Timothy chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. If you don't have anything, go home and mark this passage, verses 1 through 4. These are pinnacle, very important scriptures for the believer's prayer life. Not because of the content only, but because of the priority that is given. Notice in verse number 1, Paul says, I exhort, therefore, that first. Everyone say first.
First.
See, that indicates a priority. Not second, not third. First. First, that first of all, that supplications, which is a kind of praying, prayers, just talking about praying generally, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. And then Paul clarified so that you would know specifically who he meant by all men, for kings, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So we are commanded by the Holy Ghost on the Apostle Paul to pray for authorities and our leaders in government. And we are instructed to pray for them before we pray for ourselves. So before you pray for me, before you pray for your family, before I pray for you, before I pray for my family, we are exhorted and encouraged to first of all pray for the president, pray for the vice president, pray for the Congress, pray for senators, pray for judges, pray for our governor, pray, and you don't have to name everyone necessarily, amen, but acknowledge those offices and then pray for them. Now, why does God want us? Why is that instruction there? Notice that it's for us. It is for us. How do we know that? Well, notice because it says that we may lead. That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life. So, as Christians, God desires His best for us is that we are able to lead a quiet and peaceable Christian life, able to propagate the gospel without government persecution and hindrance. And we have not had a believing, Christian-friendly administration in the last 8 years. We have had someone antagonistic toward the expression of the church. And so, but God is saying, if you will pray for those leaders, the result will be blessing for you. That God will create an administration and a government that will leave us alone. Think about how hard it would be, how much more difficult it would be for us to witness, to preach, to get the message out, if we had to be underground. Now we're not there yet, but to the extreme, you get that example. Amen. And when how much freer and more liberty the Holy Ghost is through us to witness and to be a light and to be a source of blessing and love and help and live out the gospel and preach the gospel when there's not this hostility toward the church. Amen. And because the church had failed to pray, hello, because I'm not blaming a man, I'm blaming the church. If we don't like the way it's been, it's because of the church. Let me give you an example, because I know emotions are so, you know, raw in current day. Back in the 70s, who was president back in the 70s? Well, you in the late 70s, you had President Carter. Who'd we have before that? Ford before Carter. And before him was Nixon. Isn't that right? And we know that under President Nixon, a Republican president, that he made mistakes, didn't he? He made legal mistakes. And it created tremendous political turmoil in the nation. But if you also remember, if you were around, I was born 1972, so I was just sucking my thumb, didn't have a clue. But I know enough that the economy was horrible. The economy was horrible. You had long gas lines. The interest on to buy a house was like 20-something percent. Think about that. We're so spoiled. You know, people, well, I can do better than 3%. Think about 21% interest to get a home. So the economy, and you had Vietnam still going on in the late 60s, early 70s. You had riots. You had violence. You had burning cities. You had all kinds of things. And Brother Hagin was in the body of Christ. His ministry was not well known back then. But he was around and a leading member in the body of Christ. And he had a spiritual experience that I wanted to relate to you. Jesus appeared to him, and this is what he said. This is in that same time frame. He said, let me pick this up a little bit earlier than what I had thought. He said, I had a vision. This was 1970. I saw something. I saw three things coming up out of the Atlantic Ocean. They looked like three giant black frogs as large as whales. It's a vision. One was in midair. The other two had just stuck their heads up out of the water from the east. I had seen something similar 9 years before. Jesus said to me, you saw the same thing in 1970. Now this is 1979. I told you then exactly what they were, but you didn't do what you should have done about it. I told you back in 1970 to pray for the leaders of the nation. What happened, which was Watergate and so forth, isn't all the fault of the man who was president. I am going to hold the Christians of this nation responsible. You are the ones who allowed what happened to your nation to happen. If you had prayed, it never would have happened. I showed you what was about to happen. Go back and check. So he says, later, I went back to my archives, to the 1970 from audio tapes and manuscripts of a special meeting we held in 1970. And sure enough, I had a mini vision. And I saw three dark objects come up out of the Atlantic Ocean and leapfrog all the way across the land. If you and Christians, Jesus said, had done what you should have done, none of those things would have happened to your nation. You would not have had the riots. You would not have had the political disturbances. Your president would not have made the mistakes that he made. In fact, I am holding the church responsible for his mistakes. Yes, Brother Hagin said, I began to weep and cry, oh God. Yes, Jesus said, I am holding you and the church responsible. Then Jesus said, when you tell that to some Christians, they will laugh. But when they stand before my judgment seat and they receive the condemnation rather than the man who was then president, they won't laugh then. If Christians had done what I told them to do in the Bible, now he's referring to this right here. Amen. If they had prayed for the leaders of their nation, they would have kept the evil spirits from operating. It wasn't frogs. It was representative of demonic spirits in the realm of the spirit. You know, that he says here that happened in 1970, then it happened again in 1979. Do you know it's happened since then? And I personally know that Dr. Dufresne, after Brother Hagin went home to be with the Lord, saw the same thing. What we ought to see now, decade after decade, almost every decade, the devil is trying. He's trying the same thing to get these evil spirits to have their way and to move right across the nation. I don't have time to relate this to you, but in another vision, I got more clarity about what these evil spirits were. Dr. Dufresne said Jesus told him he saw two, and it was the spirit of socialism and atheistic communism. People get all excited about Brother Bernie Sanders. What's he preaching? Free this and free that and free this and free that and free college. And all the young people, their young skulls full of mush, they just think, oh, that's wonderful, all that free stuff. They have no idea. They haven't been taught history. Go live in the Soviet Union if you like communism. Go live in Greece where you can't get your ATM to work unless the government decides to power it up for you. Hadn't worked anywhere. It's oppressive. Boy, it's appealing though. Free cell phones. Free this. Free that. Free this. Vote for me. People fall for that. And I'm not blaming the person, but we need to know, there's a plan of the devil to take away freedom, to take away liberty, to get all the power locked up with just a few in Washington, D.C.,
yeah.
Do you know, I read a survey recently. How many of you think that this is the freest nation on the planet? That we, America, we're the home of the freest nation. We rank, according to this survey, number 26. We are 26th in personal liberty among the nations of the world. We're not in the top 3. We're not in the top 5. We're not in the top 10. We're not in the top 15. That little island of Belize down there is like number 1 in personal liberty. We think we're free. See, we're like the little frogs that have been in the boiling pot so, and they're warming it up so slow, we don't know what's happened to us, and we're getting cooked alive. Slowly, we're becoming enslaved to government. Telling you the truth about it. Dr. Dufresne, when he was here, he saw that in the spirit in his prophet's office, and he said, take care of that. So he got over in a service and the believers, and they took authority over those spirits. Well, see, Dr. Dufresne's not here anymore. Brother Hagin's not here anymore. The responsibility to pray is in our lap. And we're praying. Glory to God. We see it. I saw a picture of Times Square downtown New York yesterday, day of election. It was filled up with Christians praying for the election. From coast to coast, border to border, we were praying, you were praying, everybody's praying. And look what God did. He worked the impossible. Nobody would have, I didn't think, nobody thought. That had to, and just razor thin margins in state after state. A total miracle. Total miracle. Anyway, to continue on with this story, Jesus was talking to Brother Hagin, talking about, I'm holding you all responsible. He said, then Jesus continued, similar things, not the same things, but similar things are about to happen again. If you do not pray, they will happen. I'm not going to hold the president responsible for the nation. I'm going to hold the Christians of the nation responsible. This is what we need to realize as believers. This is our place. It doesn't matter what president gets up and says, we're not a Christian nation. Oh, yes, we are. And you saying we're not isn't going to do anything to change it. As long as I'm here in America, it's a Christian nation. And the devil cannot prevail against the church. Doesn't matter what they think. Hallelujah. Praise God. Jesus said, there will arise, unless the Christians pray, not for the same purpose that the other riots came, but there will be riots. Have we not had riots? Tumults. We've had tumults in the financial arena, the social arena, all kinds. Right? Disturbances all across the nation. Second, Jesus said, something is about to happen to the president that should not happen and will not happen if you will pray. Third, something is about to happen again that will bring trouble to the economic scene. Now, again, this is 1979, okay? Further trouble in the economic scene, in the financial structure. But Jesus said, but you can stop all three. You can stop the upheaval in the social arena. You can stop the upheaval in the activity of the devil in the political arena. You can stop the devil from disrupting the financial scene of your nation. And then he teaches in here about first things first. I want to share with you, time's getting away, I want to share with you a prophecy. I have just been holding this. were you with me, hon? This would be June's camp meeting, not this year, but last year. I don't know if you were with me. And anyway, was sitting there. Pastor, we'd had a wonderful service. Pastor Nancy was trying to close, and then all of a sudden her countenance changed. And the Spirit of God came on her, and she began to prophesy. And she said, and this is a year and a half ago, she said, ahead of this next election, two men who are not currently on the scene will be raised up, and that it is the church's job to pray and oversee that these two men are protected and that they are strengthened for the task. He said, this is what Pastor Nancy prophesied, for this next election will be a manifestation of my mercy for this nation. Creating a window, now this is my paraphrase, creating a window of time for this era, to assist the church in this era. Uncharted territory.
Yeah.
But then he said, yet it will only be temporary, for after a time it will turn back and go the other way. Now, see, I've shared the fullness of that prophecy with you now. See, it's come to pass. You can check the dates. I'll find it. You could, if you go back onto their website, she's got those meetings. They're all there. And we're not making this up after the fact. What I wanted to tell you is that God, in His mercy for this nation and for the good of the church, for the good of the church, we have a window. We have a window of time to get with it and to get as much done, right? To get as much done in this new era as possible before it turns to go the other way. So don't stop praying now. That's my message tonight. Don't think, okay, we won a great victory. God's done great things for us. It's all good now because He's in there. Listen, He has asked. He has asked. Right? He has asked for the church to pray for Him. How many of you think, no matter what you think of Him, we ought to do that in the light of this Scripture? In the light of this Scripture, we ought to pray for Him. Amen. And again, the church prayed, and look what God did. He overcame everything the devil threw at this particular candidate, because the devil knew that God was raising up two men for this plan and purpose. Threw everything up to and including the kitchen sink and the plumbing underneath and the cabinet and everything else at him. Defies all reason, but he's going to be the next president of the United States. Amen. So in closing, it's been interesting, you know, praying, us praying. We had our senior lunch here, and for those that came, we just prayed. It was election day. We decided to pray. And I'll be honest with you. I didn't know, Miss Peggy, I know you pray a lot. I didn't know what to pray. What would work? What would help? You know? I didn't really know. So, and you'll face this praying for the president, but you'll face this praying for me. You'll face this praying for a lot of situations. How do you pray when you don't know what to pray? Let's go to one more scripture. We have time for that. Over to Romans chapter 8. And I'll show you, how come I just can't say it or release my faith? Well, again, the prayer of faith won't work for every situation. Sometimes you've got to tap into the agency of the Holy Ghost and pray things out in the Spirit. So right now we're getting ready to close, but we're talking about, in any situation, when I don't know what to pray, how do I pray then? Okay? The Bible tells us what to do. In Romans 8, verse 26, notice what it says. Paul said, likewise the Spirit. So, the Holy Ghost is being emphasized, right? Mm-hmm. Likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Now, the New King James says, for the Spirit helps our weaknesses. Well, what is the weakness he's referring to? Not knowing in that situation what to pray. And when you know you need to pray, well, that's a weakness. So the answer when we feel weak, we don't know what to pray, is the Spirit. The helper. The Holy Spirit is your helper in every arena. He is your helper in prayer. So let's read on. We'll find more out about this. For we know not what. He didn't say we don't know how to pray. He says there are times we don't know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit... Now, the King James says itself, that's bad. It says, in the Greek, it's himself. The Holy Ghost is not an it.
Right.
But the Holy Spirit himself makes intercession for us. That would be better translated through us with groanings which cannot be uttered. This is not only a reference to groanings in the Spirit, but it's a reference to tongues. Praying in that heavenly language. And see, every time you say that, some people shut you off. Well, you do that to your great peril. Because I've seen people that have been in the church and love them. We're so glad, precious. If you're not a tongue talker, stay here. We love you. You're a believer, I'm a believer. Glory. But when we go off praying this way, I watch them and they just sit. They cannot participate. They cannot be a supply. They don't know what to pray, so they have to sit there in silence. They cannot make a difference. When you reject this part of Christianity, you handicap yourself. You handicap yourself. But isn't it wonderful when I don't know how to pray for my kids? I don't know what I should pray for, rather, for my kids. Does the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Does the Spirit of God?
Yes.
There's a whole lot of decisions that are going to be made by this new president in the next 2 months. Who is he going to pick to be around him?
Right.
Who's going to be speaking into his ear on matters of economy, military, legislation, judicial matters? You think that matters? Oh, it matters. By wise counsel, a man makes war. Do you think that we could not have some influence as this administration is putting these teams together? Come on, somebody.
Yes.
I challenge you in days ahead. Father, I lift up the decisions going on by Donald Trump and key leaders about who's going to serve in this administration. I pray, Father God, that right men and women of your choosing, would be known and raised up for the specific task to speak wisdom and righteousness and God's answer into his ear.
Yes.
And then you feel like you ought to pray about that further. Long don't go. Father, I just pray. I just lift this before your throne. Holy Spirit, help me to pray about this. Mando sol nam. Right, and just take off. You keep reading that, you'll find out that when you do that, you're praying the perfect, perfect will of God. You're praying the perfect will of God. You're not praying imperfectly, you are praying perfectly, perfectly. And then oftentimes, it happened yesterday, as I was praying, and other people that were there having lunch prayed good things in English. But one of the things that God gave me, I believe, was he reminded me of Dr. Dufresne's testimony. That when he was born, when he was conceived in his mother's womb, he was a surprise. He was born to his mother out of wedlock, or they got pregnant out of wedlock. And back in that day, it wasn't like today. I mean, that was bad, bad, bad. And they were on their way, she and her boyfriend, which is his daddy, down to Tijuana to get an abortion. And later, in later years, God showed Dr. Frank how this went down. He took him back to 1940, wherever it was. He was in the back seat of this car. Their mom and dad are driving down to Tijuana to abort him. And an angel shows up in that car and touches his daddy on the head. And his daddy turns to his mom and says, "Honey, we can't do this. I'm Catholic. We can't do this. This is wrong. We're going to go down here and get married." So see, God reminded me that angel went down there and touched him and changed that guy's mind. You know what I believe? What I prayed was, I said, "Father, there's an innumerable company of angels. And I release the angels to go and influence people. And as they step into the voting box intending to vote one way, hit them on the head, Lord. Hit them on the head, Father." And I really believe, I just do, I believe that somebody walked out of the voting booth going,
right.
Yeah. Hallelujah. See, God will make you skillful in prayer. He'll remind you of things. But even if you're just clueless, when you're praying in that unknown tongue, it's perfect. 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 So I didn't have it typed up. I felt like I was rushing it. But for the national level, I just think here'd be a good assignment for this body of believers to take up. Praying specifically about these choices in his cabinet and leaders. that we would get, that God would give us the right men and women. The right men and women. There's a lot to be done. You know? And the second thing is his choice to replace Antonin Scalia on the Supreme Court. Right now, the people that want to go ungodly, that gave us gay marriage and gave us all this junk, they have four. Right? With Antonin Scalia gone, we have three. Right? That's four. Then there's Kennedy. Kennedy kind of swings back and forth. So that would give us, we have three. Right? We need this choice to be right. We need it to be right. And I don't know about you, but I'm challenging you. Join me. I'm going to begin to lift up. It's one of the first things that will come down. This choice. The decisions that will be made on the Supreme Court that this young man lives under for 30 or 40 years will be determined by this choice. Whether he can have a firearm or not. Whether he can say to people in love that homosexuality is a sin. There's a lot of forces on that court that don't want us to be able to say that. Seriously. You know? That God would get God raise up the right one. And then you can join me on this, but this is kind of my private challenge. I am going to pray Justice Ginsburg out of there. You know, who's that? Well, you need to find out about these things, but she, God bless her. She's getting pretty old. She needs Jesus. She needs Jesus, but she's dangerous for that court. And I just believe we've got the authority. I've been inspired looking at this. Oh, we've got the authority. The church, if God will do this when we pray, what else can we get done with our prayer life? What else can we get done with this, right? Father, I just dismiss in Jesus' name Justice Ginsburg from her place on the Supreme Court. Pray her out. What if this president, who could be influenced by God, could choose three? What if he could choose three? The oldest ones on the court are the leftist-leaning ones. Then we could stack the court with godly men and women who revere the Constitution. How about that? Instead of this thing going the other way, I'm telling you how close it's been, this thing swinging. I don't think we probably appreciate the magnitude of what happened last night. And it's because we prayed. God did it, but it's because the church prayed. And I'm challenging you, engage in this kind of praying. Don't stop praying now. Stand up. Let's stand up tonight. Praise God. I'm going to minister to someone before we go.